Good afternoon and welcome to another episode of Singapore Analyzed, where we delve into certain topics of interest here in Singapore, ranging from the government, to tourism and even to multiculturalism.
In the year 1854, Singapore Volunteer Rifle Corps was set up as a volunteer organization to help maintain the internal security of the steadily growing nation. In 1888, the SVRC renamed itself the Singapore Volunteer Artillery. This fighting force proved itself when it helped to suppress the 1915 mutiny of the local sepoys. In 1922, the SVC renamed itself once again as a Straits Settlement Volunteer Force, so as to include the volunteer forces from neighbouring countries such as Malacca and Penang. In the 1930s, Singapore was a hive of activity as the British prepared for World War II. During the war, the British were the main fighting force, while the SSVF and other local fighting forces assisted mainly through guerrilla warfare and sabotage. Although the war had ended in 1945, Singaporeans lost faith in the British's ability to defend them against enemies after the failure against the Japanese. Singapore wanted to have its own capable fighting force. The SSVF was later disbanded and reconstituted in 1949 as the Singapore Volunteer Corps again, to help maintain domestic peace. In 1965, this was renamed the People's Defence Force. The year 1951 was a very important year for Singapore's military. It was the year the 1st Battalion of Regular Soldiers was formed, known as the 1st Singapore Infantry Regiment, which would later form the SAF. During the next few years, Singapore was slowly gaining full internal governments, before the 2nd Singapore Infantry Regiment was formed in 1962. The next year, Singapore became part of Malaysia, and the 1st SIR joined the Malaysian Army, under the name 1st MIR. In that very year, the policy of confrontation by Indonesia, the Konfrontasi, was launched, resulting in several different raids within Malaysia. During that period of time, both the battalions of the Singapore Infantry Regiment and the SVC were deployed by Malaysia to help counter the Indonesians. It finally ended on October 1965, soon after Singapore separated from Malaysia. The plan actually began back in 1965 when the Ministry of Interior and Defence was formed, led by Minister Goh Keng Swee. In the same year, the PDF Bill was passed, which enabled the government to train a defensive force made up of volunteers. However, this was not enough. The National Service Bill was also passed in 1967, which resulted in a group of about 9,000 male citizens being made eligible for NS. Rules were set in place to ensure that male citizens 18 years of age that year were enlisted. An astounding figure of over 90% of the 9,000 men registered by April 1967, just a month after NS was first announced.
Singapore spent 6% of her GDP on military defence. In 2012 alone, she spent $12.3 billion on military defence. Where does all this money go to? They go to four main areas, namely investments in human capital, new capabilities, some opportunity buys, and military equipment.
Singapore invests on the training and development of well-trained personnel. Most of the investments goes into national service, where young men train for 2 years. The rest of the investment is for training reservists, where the skills of older NS men are refreshed. Singapore invests over $250 million annually on defense R&D to test and develop indigenous technological innovations to sharpen Singapore's defense capabilities. Due to Singapore's investment, Singapore has a huge pile of military equipment that's ready to be used. Some of the many equipments are 196 battle tanks, 1,335 armored carriers, and 500,000 direct fire weapons. According to many ranking websites such as globalfire.com and nationmaster.com, Singapore is very well equipped with military equipment and troops as compared to our immediate neighbors in Southeast Asia. Although we are statistically safe from immediate neighbors, the United States, Russia, and China are all far more superior in military strength as compared to Singapore.
Now, I'll be talking about battlefield knowledge. This includes urban and jungle warfare. Urban warfare will be more commonly used in Singapore as there are more built-up areas here.
Jungle warfare is a term used to cover the special techniques needed for military units to survive and fight in jungle terrain. Dense vegetation limits lines of sight and arcs of fire, but also provide camouflage and plenty of material to build fortifications with. Jungle terrain can be inaccessible to vehicles, placing a premium on air mobility. Jungle environments can also be inherently unhealthy, with various tropical diseases that have to be prevented or treated by medical services. Urban warfare is combat conducted in urban areas such as towns and cities. Complicating factors in urban warfare include the presence of civilians and the complexity of the urban terrain. In 2014, the Murai Urban Live Firing Facility was opened by Defense Minister Ng Eng Hen. Soldiers can better hone their urban warfare skills, train in a more sophisticated and safe environment. This facility allows soldiers to storm a building, fire live ammunition at close quarters, and practice throwing grenades. Defense Minister said soldiers today are more likely to fight in urban scenarios. When asked if jungle warfare is still relevant, he claimed that while our soldiers should not forgo their skills in areas such as jungle missions and terrain, it is more important to train in more realistic and relevant scenarios, especially since our army is more of a defensive force. Thus, our soldiers are well trained for almost any unexpected outcome. Of course, other countries have also been rapidly progressing battlefield knowledge to ensure the safety of their civilians.
Now, I'll be talking about the morale and mindset of National Servicemen and SAF soldiers. These soldiers will have to maintain good discipline and keep up high morale. Therefore, they are trained to do so.
The primary mission for National Service is to instill discipline and values among the young, according to a new study on perception on the rite of passage. Disciplining and inculcating values in young, able-bodied males edged out National Defence to be NS's most important purpose for the 1,250 Singaporeans who were asked what NS means to them. Most feel that National Service have changed their lifestyle and the way they behave into that of good character. The Singapore Armed Forces' core values include loyalty to country, leadership, discipline, professionalism, fighting spirit, ethics, care for soldiers, and safety. Discipline means inner strength, self-control, mental stamina, physical toughness, and perseverance. A high standard of discipline must be maintained to train soldiers to withstand fear and tension. Disciplined soldiers can be dependent on. All these values are to be upheld by all soldiers, and this shows the mindset of each and every soldier in Singapore.
Now, I'll be talking about the manpower of the Singapore Armed Forces, which includes the number of combat and non-combat personnel.
Singapore Armed Forces currently has around 71,600 members as active frontline personnel and around 950 other citizens as active reserve personnel. The reservists make up around 80% of Singapore's defense system. Every year, there are also around 50,000 citizens reaching military age, thus effectively supplementing the reservist group. Though the defense system is primarily male, females can sign on as career regular soldier in both combat and non-combat roles, such as combat officers, but mostly in clerical and logistic positions in the earlier years. There is also a SAF volunteer corps of around 300 members established, allowing first-generation permanent residents and citizens to contribute to the system.
One of the few main shortfalls of the SAF would be the fact that they will be severely outnumbered and facing almost any army, putting us at a disadvantage. Also, being a concrete jungle, war on Singapore will cause huge damages and result in a lot of civilians killed. Artilleries are simply not an option. Should Malaysia or Indonesia ever invade us, the situation may be bleak. However, we still have a chance. Singapore spends way more money on military and have a lot more advanced technology as compared to other countries, such as Apaches and F-15s, giving us huge advantages during warfare. One of the first things we'll have to do during war will be to push our advantages while preventing invaders from setting foot here. Singapore will have to establish air superiority to prevent air raids while pressuring the invaders. Statistically, we have more military aircrafts than Malaysia, but fewer than Indonesia. However, well-trained pilots and technology helps to counter their huge numbers. By obtaining air superiority, Singapore will be able to better fend off invaders. Singapore also has the largest submarine fleet in the region that poses a huge threat due to the technology it boasts. In order to stay afloat, Singapore will have to be able to retaliate and pressure the enemy to back off by causing damage to the invading country. Should supplies be cut off, Singapore will be able to last 3 months on the water and food reserves. Ultimately, Singapore will be able to defend itself during the initial phase and is well capable of causing massive damage to invaders. However, to be able to win the war, Singapore will require the help of its allies to help supplement our forces.
In conclusion, the SAF boasts many points that makes it one of the best militaries in the world. Be it in technology, morale, economy, equipment or training, Singapore is much more advanced than the other countries in the region. Therefore, despite a disadvantage in terms of manpower, we believe that Singapore will be able to sufficiently defend itself without external help. Of course, with alliances with some of the world's most powerful countries such as the US and China, Singapore is very unlikely to be invaded for decades to come. With that, we end our episode of Singapore Analyzed. Hope you have learned something, and peace out.